Dear colleagues, I'm very glad to be here to participate in the conference in such a beautiful city as Barcelona. And I would like, in my paper, to summarize some recent information of the most important issues of study, preservation, and use of the Karelian rock art. Petroglyphs of Karelia are an important part of the northern Scandinavian prehistoric rock art. There are two large clusters in Karelia, one of them on the eastern shore of Onega Lake, and the second in the Arctic, subarctic zone in the delta of the Vyg River, close to the city Belomorsk. These petroglyphs are very remarkable samples of Neolithic rock art. Such sites have always been under the scrutiny of scientists and amateurs since their discovery. The Onega rock caverns were first discovered in 1842, and this September we are celebrating the 170th anniversary. Okay, thank you. Petroglyphs of Karelia are always located very close to the water. The site have been preserved in non-disturbed environment, which is similar to how it was when they were carved. And the level of preservation of the rock art itself is very nice. At least it exceeds all known rock art sites in the northern Finnoscandia in this relation. One of the central rock art panel on the eastern shore of Onega Lake, it's a famous base of nose, that means demon's cape. And we have more than 200 carvings on the top of this age. And the main motifs are birds, swans, even very big ones. Some petroglyphs are located on the very scenic capes, and in six cases they are on the islands, mainly small islands. There is a big Guri island with two rock art locations, and you see that ancient artists quite often used some features of the rock art surface. Mainly, the granite of Onega Lake is red, more or less reddish, or sometimes they're gray. In this case, we see gray spots, so-called xenoliths, and people used this like, well, maybe like a canvas. In recent time, we could discover some rock art panels on the bottom of the lake, close to the, practically close, besides every caves with petroglyphs. One of the recent discovery, that was because of the broken process, because of the ice and water, and some panels, some parts of fragments of stones occurred on the bottom. And we tried to study them with the help of amateurs, volunteers, divers from St. Petersburg. Totally, we managed to discover about 20 petroglyphs, and they are mainly swans again. As I say, main motifs are swans. They are both realistic and fantastic. And the biggest swan figure is 4 meters in length. The second popular motif in Onega rock carvings are so-called solar and lunar signs. There are big discussions so far. People's researchers don't know the exact meaning of these mysterious images. But our observations show that practically all these signs have a kind of rims. It may be one, two, three, and sometimes very complicated shape, and mostly of them are oriented into western or eastern direction. So it really could be a solar and lunar signs. Anthropomorphic figures also are among predominant rock art motifs. The most famous anthropomorphic figure over 2.5 meters in size, so called Bess, and it gives the name for the cape, Bess of North, Bess of Cape. In the 16th century, the monks of nearby monastery carved an Orthodox cross on this, partly covering this fantastic figure. White sea petroglyph landscape. The white sea petroglyphs are to the north, 300 kilometers, and the landscape is quite different. The main site there is Lavruga, is the largest rock cut in the European part of Russia, and count about 2,000 separate carvings in this area. The size of area is about 1 hectare. And this is accepted to be the most impressive, accessible, and the most important site among the Karelian petroglyphs. Here you have seen some famous motifs, complex narrative compositions of the Zalavruga site. White sea petroglyphs are known since 1926. And the ease of travel and high level of visitation to these petroglyphs make them extremely attractive for safe and sustainable tourism. The narrative petroglyph panels with many individual figures showing a chain of events are very rare among the rock carvings in northern Finnskandia and even wider. the active research into Karelian rock art was continued in the end of 90s, the most terrible years in Russia. But at that time, we got very big assistance and financial support from Norway and from Cambridge University also. Since 1997, multidisciplinary monitoring has been carried out on the entire rock art areas. And later, collaborative projects between research teams from Russia and Cambridge University, led by Liliana Janik. And from Norway, Knut Helskog was the main participant in all our investigations. Later, in 2013-2014, there was a Russian-Finnish NPI CPC project, Rukat Bridge. It was a cooperation with Finland. And this project contributed very much in creation of some tourist infrastructures in the Lavruga area. Of course, by dissemination of knowledge about this site among the local population in Russia and in Finland. In recent time, we tried to attract to our work on rock art local population and volunteers from all Russia. And these are some examples of how the Lavruga is cleaning by local school children and volunteers from Moscow. The matter is that this big area, very often a lot of bushes, moss, and especially lichen, different kind of lichen, and we have to periodically to clean this area and make it visible for visitors. Fresh Russian project documented of Karelian rock art sites was in progress during 2016 and 2017. And new method of rubbing was proposed by famous Karelian artist Svetlana Georgievskaya, whose started doing rubbings on nickel and paper since 2006. And the last 2 years, she decided to use for that aim special rice Chinese paper. She usually uses black paper, and it's very good for revealing both shape and internal packing of the image. And of course, all these rubbings are very popular in the museum exhibitions. And this October, she is going to present the results of her work in South Korea in the symposium devoted to the rock art. And I could tell a lot about our recent activities, which could protect to some extent our sites, both Onega Lake, Petroglyphs, and the White Sea areas. But to be in short, I should say that Petroglyphs of Onega Lake and the White Sea area are one of the most famous cultural and tourist brands in Karelia. But they have not yet become a real value for local society. And our task was to involve them in understanding the importance of this cultural resource. Now an important task is creation an open air museum on the both of rock art areas. And of course, the problem of conservation is still, despite of the relatively high preservation degree, minor impact of natural and anthropogenic factors, petroglyphs of Karelia are caused by slow weathering, lichens, water, ice, etc., and need to be sustainably protected and properly managed. The true preservation of rock art for future generations requires a whole complex of serious measures from the state involving other stakeholders, individuals, and sufficient funding. I would like to add that in June this year, we had an international conference devoted to the rock art as a resource, as a World Heritage resource. And 40 participants from different countries participated in this conference, and we decided that petroglyphs of Karelia are worth to be included in the UNESCO Heritage List, and now we started preparing this nomination for the tentative list of UNESCO. Of course, we are facing with some difficulties when we write this nomination, and especially in terms of comparative analysis and how to prove, to explain the outstanding value, international value of this resource. And once more, I would like to say that lately they have published several literature about Karelian rock art. It's my monograph Petroglyphs on Onega Lake, the second with my colleague Filatova, devoted to the other archaeological sites in the vicinity of Onega rock carvings, and several guidebooks. I have with me a guidebook for Zalabuga in English, and those who want to maintain them. Thank you.